It's Wednesday. It's 7 o'clock. It's time for Magic TV. I'm Mashi Scanlon, the guy on the left. With me, very special guest, Brian DeMars. Brian, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
No, this is awesome. Obviously, you know, Paul is, you know, on an extended trip. He went from L.A. to Albuquerque. We touched base in Albuquerque, and he's already in Spain. So thank you for filling in, Brian. It's good to have you. We actually haven't met before, so it's always kind of weird when I meet someone for the first time via Skype on Magic TV. But welcome. Glad to have you.
Once again, thanks for having me. I'm blessed to be here.
Nice, nice, nice. We also, of course, have Darksteel Humphrey and another special fill-in. Behind the camera, Channel Fireball Editor-in-Chief, Andy Cooperfaus. So, very, very exciting Magic TV for you this week. We kind of cobbled together last minute, as is a tradition here, but we've got tons of great stuff to talk about. There's this GP Barcelona mishap for the top eight. We'll dive into that. The DFC sleeving controversy. We're changing up draft just for the Pro Tour, kind of at the 11th hour, but I think we'll get into it more. I actually kind of like it. Then there's the Pro Tour Shadows Over Innistrad Draft Primer. What we know about Shadows Over Innistrad standards so far. Brian, my understanding is you have some sleeper picks for the Pro Tour. I have my own. We haven't compared notes, so we'll have to see if there's any overlap. But Brian, you're actually good at Magic, and I am not, so I'm confident there won't be much overlap. And then we have a great top eight for you this week. But before we get into all of that, a few bases to cover. One, Magic TV and our Magic TV top eights are brought to you by channelfireball.com, where you can go and shop to your heart's content for any Magic the Gathering items you'd like. We've been constantly restocking our Shadows Over Innistrad inventory, so if there's any SOI cards you're looking for, and I guarantee there are going to be a few you're looking for at the end of this weekend, check out channelfireball.com. We're fully stocked, and like I said, if we're running low on something or out of something, keep checking, because we are constantly turning over inventory. Secondly, we have two Grand Prix coming up in May. We have Grand Prix New York, and then 2 weeks later, Grand Prix Los Angeles. You can get all the information on both those events at gpny2016.com or gpla2016.com. Information on both Grand Prix are up. I think New York, I'm like 99.99% sure that one's capping. Okay, there's a maximum capacity. It's, I believe it's 2,500. Register for that. Book your tickets, book your hotel room, book your registration for that event, because it will cap. Los Angeles has a really good chance of capping. I think the recent changes in the modern environment have sparked that fire for modern once again. So if you plan on attending either of those GPs, please, please, please pre-register. Don't be caught in that crunch where there's no room for you because you didn't pre-register. So check out both of those. I also want to send a very special thank you out to RIW Hobbies in Livonia, Michigan. That is where Brian is joining us from. Is that correct, Brian?
That is correct.
Nice. Is that your kind of your local haunt, your F&M spot?
That's my local game store. So, I play there every week.
Nice. Thank you very much, RIW Hobbies. Also, Brian, my understanding is you got a podcast that you're putting out there called Painful Truths. Why don't you tell us a little bit about that?
It's a podcast that I do with a couple of my friends from RIW, my friend Devin, my friend Zach, and my friend Raja. And we just talk about standard and modern. It's a lot of fun. We did an interview today with the Invitational champion, Max McVitie. It'll be up later this week. So, and you can find that on the RIW Hobbies website.
Nice. So we can check out that Painful Truths podcast with Brian, of course. Follow you on Twitter at BrianDeMars1. So we'll have to check you out on Twitter and stay up to date with Painful Truths and everything else going on with you. So there we go. Let's dive right into this GP Barcelona top eight mistake. I assume you followed this or heard about this, Brian?
I did hear about it, yes.
So, first of all, right off the bat, I have to say, you know, let me explain the situation here. There was an error with Walter, which is the Wizards Large Tournament event reporter, or just reporter. I guess there's no E, but we all call it Walter for short. We use it to scorekeep large events like Grand Prix and Pro Tours, and it's a newer software. It's on development. It's doing a lot of It's developing and growing Grand Prix in a lot of great ways if you want the inside baseball track on it. But there seems to be a hiccup. And apparently there was, at one point, a loss of all the results for round 14. And they went ahead and played round 15 because they had that paired up correctly. And went into the top eight directly after round 15 based on the tiebreakers they had for round 15. The decision was made not to enter everything for round 14 because the estimate was it was going to take about an hour of time to do that. Now, the consequence here is the person who ended up apparently finishing in eighth place for the Grand Prix was actually the ninth place finisher, and the ninth place finisher was the eighth place finisher. So Mr. Ninth Place in this case didn't get to play in his top eight that he earned. Wizards of the Coast ended up, I think, doing the best they could by him, which was cutting him a check for $2,500. He already had one invite based on having 39 pro points, a flight and an invite for the next pro tour, and they extended that invite for the following pro tour, Honolulu. Keep in mind, the percentage here was 0.02%. That was the tiebreak percentage between 8 and 9. And that's got to cut deep when you know you didn't get your chance to play in that top 8. So if you're Mr. Ninth Place in this case, you should have been in 8th place, but they ended up putting you in 9, so you didn't make a top 8. How do you feel, Brian?
I'd be pretty crushed. I mean, Wizards really put between a rock and a hard place on this one, because there's not a way to like really make it right all the way around, you know, because the thing that has the most value is actually getting to sit down and play in that top eight. It's a really big accomplishment. It's a tournament really hard fought, well played, and you know, at the end of it, when you find out you should have been in and a technicality you didn't make it, that seems pretty crushing. So I would be crushed. I'd be really upset.
Yeah, you know, I completely agree with you. You know, on the one hand, Wizards can only do so much to solve the problem after the fact. You can't unring the bell. The top eight's already happened. You're getting a check. That's great. You're getting a lot more money than you thought you did in ninth place. You can say you made the top eight of a Grand Prix, but it doesn't quite feel that way. You know, like I definitely think you're entitled to say, hey, I top eighted a GP, even though I didn't play in the top eight.
And you never got a chance to play for the trophy, you know? You want that trophy. Mm-hmm. Like, the trophy is the best part about playing Magic.
Yeah.
And you played well enough to get to that elimination round, and you never got a chance to play. So, I mean, that's rough.
Yeah. And it's, I think it's a classic case of, again, Wizards of the Coast, I think, doing everything right, doing what they could, but it's still just not quite being enough because you can't make up for that intangible shortfall. There's nothing you can do. And it's funny because in professional sports, you know, nowadays, particularly, keep in mind, I'm in the Bay Area. I'm a Giants fan. There's all this talk of asterisks in the record books. So does this top eight have an asterisk next to it?
I feel like if it came down to, you know, like Hall of Fame voting or something at some point down the line, that like you kind of got to give them the nod for top eighting this one, even though we didn't technically get into the top eight, you know?
Does it affect how you feel about everyone else on top eight? I mean, he could have won the whole Grand Prix, right? There's nothing to say that he doesn't win this Grand Prix if he gets his nod in the top eight. Now, I get we're stretching a point here, but there's certainly nothing that says, you know, it's not like you could just close the books on and say, well, he came in eighth, because we really don't know.
Yeah. You can't take it away from anyone else who, you know, made top eight and how they finished. It's just an unfortunate circumstance, you know?
Yeah.
It's one of those, like, you look at it, it's kind of embarrassing. And that's just motivation to do it better next time, I think.
Yeah, and I obviously, coming from Channel Fireball, we run a ton of Grand Prix, and just I really feel for everyone that's on that main event stage, scorekeeping and judging that event. When a glitch like that happens and you're really stuck trying to make a snap decision, and 0.02% of a tiebreaker error there is just, that is so soul-rending, so... but I don't want to beat a dead horse on this. I do feel like Wizards did the best they could in the scenario, you know, extending the second invite with a plane ticket, and then, you know, the $2,500 cash prize. So,
feels fair.
It does. And if there's anything we can feel good about, we can at least feel good about that. And hopefully we don't have any issues like that in LA or New York. Any final thoughts on this GP Barcelona top eight controversy?
I think we nailed it.